Good evening and welcome to the Great Hall for the 49th Tillotson Lecture. It is a huge pleasure to welcome you to the hall this evening for all of the usual reasons, but of course this year the additional reason of being able to gather in such a format to have our lecture as we are accustomed to having it in person. So it is a great pleasure to welcome you on behalf of Nick Ford, the head of Boys Division, who is at an international education conference this evening. The topic for our 49th Marcus Tillotson Lecture is To Live is to Serve, Making a Difference in the Modern World. And that is a theme so much a core purpose of Bolton School life that it is a really interesting and important topic for us all this evening that I'm sure our distinguished speakers and alumni will guide us through and give us plenty of food for thought. So as is the custom at the Tillotson Lecture, let me ask Ali Ahmed, the captain of school, to make the introductions.
Good evening. Tonight I would like to warmly welcome back and introduce Max Hopkinson and Philip Worthington to the school for the 49th Tillotson Lecture held here in the Great Hall. Both Mr. Hopkinson and Mr. Worthington are founders of organizations of international recognition and pedigree. Mr. Hopkinson is the chief instructor and co-founder of Bind, a marketing agency with a unique and innovative methodology. Mr. Worthington is the founder of a human rights charity called European Lawyers in Lesbos, who provide much needed legal aid to asylum seekers in Greece. Please can you all give a round of applause to our two speakers who will be discussing how we can make a difference in the world.
Philip will introduce himself a little more in his own talk, but Max will speak first. And because of the nature of his talk, he will say not so much about himself, so it falls to me to do a little bit more of that, but not at any length. It is true that Max is an old boy of the school. It's well known that on these occasions I look at the files of old boys of the school to find material, but on this occasion I must note that much of it is redacted. So that was not a useful source of information. But what we have found in our researchers is a person who very much sees the school and his family background as driving him to be engaged in doing good for others. And it is that that we look forward to hearing about this evening. Max.
The title of my lecture tonight is Hoppy's Four Principles to Philanthropy. And I feel bad about this next bit, so I'm sorry. AKA, how to raise a shitload for charity and live a good life. And that is the only profanity in this lecture, but I'm really sorry. Okay. My dad died 6 months and 14 days ago today. It was a shock. He was a young man, he was 61, and he was very fit. He'd climbed Kilimanjaro 10 times in the last decade. He had recently cycled across Africa. And in January of 2021, he'd asked me and my two brothers if we would run 100-kilometer ultra marathon with him, and we told him to get lost. 2 weeks before he died, my dad and my whole family were in Mallorca, in the northern part of the island, in Old Town Pienza. We sat in the square, which is a beautiful square. If you've not been, you should go. Beautiful cathedral. Everyone's outside eating. Loads of children running around. My kids were some of those children running around. And this is my last memory of my dad outside of hospital. He was sat in a chair with a ridiculous amount of ice cream. And I can see my mother nodding at me. He'd always volunteer to order the ice cream. And he had this obscene amount of ice cream. We all had some ice cream. And I looked at him and I clocked him, looking really content. He looked like he was living his best life. And he was. My dad was happy. He was having impact. He was at peak impact. Like a rock star that goes at the height of their popularity, my dad left us at top impact. And most of that impact was through his charity work. Now, for those of you that don't know my dad, to introduce him, I'll use his words from his social media bio. Here goes. Nick Hopkinson, MBE, DL, known to most as Hoppy. Philanthropist and fundraiser. Ex-High Sheriff of Cheshire, teetotal, adventurous, entrepreneurial, eccentric 60-something who is a happy liver cancer survivor so far. Married to an amazing woman for 38 years, father to three happy young men who make me proud almost every day. Raising cash to help positively impact the lives of young people keeps me motivated, fit, and content. This is a great adventure, and I'm loving it. So today, I want to get into Hoppy's philanthropy. I'm going to talk about four principles that I think were kind of wired him and guided his kind of operating system. The first principle is about mindset. It's about thinking big. The second principle is about deeply connecting with the work that the charity you're helping is doing. Principle three is actually an opportunistic one. It's about leveraging charity to help your business. And finally, principle four is about doing what you love and helping others at the same time. And I'll pull the thing together, the lecture together, by sharing how living with the man for 18 years and being his son for 37 has influenced me and some of my behavior. Without further ado, principle one. Principle one, think big. As a guide, think 10 times bigger than where your comfort level is. Hoppy started working with Bolton Lads and Girls Club in the early 90s. He connected with the club's purpose. In very simple terms, the club helped and still helps disadvantaged young people by giving them a place to go and things to do. And it's filled with people that care and are consistent, which a lot of these children don't have in their home lives. So Hoppy loved the club's purpose. And I think it reminded him of he thought of my granddad quite a lot. My granddad was an orphan and had a break and come good. And he saw the club's work, I think, as helping children like my granddad on a kind of greater scale. So he loved the club, but he felt they were leaving a lot on the table. He felt there was a lot of potential and a lot of children that weren't getting helped, that with more ambition could change. So what did Hoppy do? Well, he kind of appointed himself in a leadership role. I suspect he wasn't asked to do this, but his style was to kind of elbow his way in. And he set a vision. He sketched out an idea that to most was probably balmy, of a state-of-the-art youth leisure facility that would make the David Lloyd Leisure Centre look a bit rubbish. And as inspiring as that was, most thought he was off his rocker. The club at the time was costing a couple of hundred grand to run, and that's probably what they were raising each year. Hoppy's vision required 5 million quid. But Hoppy found the money. Hoppy found £1 million. You know, I don't want to say it was all on his own, but he catalysed £1 million of fundraising. And with his help, they convinced the National Lottery to give a £4 million grant, which at the time was just an unheard of thing for a regional club in Bolton to receive that kind of check, excuse me, from the National Lottery. And they built the club that you know, that those of you that know it, that exists today on Spa Road. And thousands more children were helped by thinking big. Now, in preparation for this lecture, I called the club's old CEO, Jerry Glover, and I said, what was it like to work with Hoppy? And he said, Max, for 10 years, I was just deeply uncomfortable. Hoppy made us do all this scary stuff that we did not think we could do, but with him behind us, kind of making us do it, we did it. And we totally surprised ourselves, and in the process helped thousands of children. And I think this is actually the point. I think it's easy to say think big, think 10 times bigger. When you think big, fear, uncertainty, doubt, anxiety floods you. And it did Hoppy. Hoppy was no different. I believe this happens to everyone, apart from maybe psychopaths. Like, this is a human reaction to thinking in a grand way. But what Hoppy showed people is that you don't need to be defined by your fear. And the limits and the caps it sets on you just leaves a load on the table. So by his own action and dragging people with him, Hoppy showed with his work at Bolton Lads and Girls Club what happens when you think big. And don't let fear cap what you can deliver. Okay, let's move on. Principle two. I'm going to stick with Bolton Lads and Girls Club for this principle. So principle two is connect deeply with the work that you're doing, and particularly the money that you're raising, what it's being spent on. Connect deeply with that stuff. Now, Bolton Lads and Girls Club had a very successful boxing program, and I believe it still does. But this is early 90s, successful boxing program. And it worked because the kids signed up and they were up for it, because boxing was cool. The genius of the boxing program, though, is that it was a Trojan horse to give these children a lot of things that they needed. Structure, discipline, purpose, the lesson of being knocked down and having to get back up again. All the good stuff. So when Hoppy found out about this program, he decided to run an annual fundraiser at Bolton Town Hall. It was a black tie event, and the best Bolton Lads and Girls Club fighters would go toe-to-toe with the army boxing team. And the people that were in attendance would see firsthand these children with, you know, walking into, you know, how scary is that? Walking into a bloody boxing ring with heads held high, confidence, pride. And again, they wouldn't always win, but they would get back up and they would lose with grace. And things that, sadly, I'd say, chuckle, the boxing team often won. But that actually wasn't the point. And the people in attendance would see what their money was being spent on. And they would give more money. And that, in turn, would make the boxing program better, and that this virtuous circle is created. So if we prod this principle a bit, it's more than just connecting with where the money's going. It's about leveraging that connection in your fundraising stories. Hoppy always did this. He'd make his stories personal, highly relatable, emotional. He would believe them. In then asking people for money and telling stories, he was far more convincing, and his impact was compounded. So that's principle two. Connecting deeply, more than connecting, leveraging your connection that you've got with your fundraising in your fundraising stories. Principle three, the one that is slightly naughty, supercharging your business with your charity work. So I said this was opportunistic. It is. My dad was opportunistic. I think his compass, his kind of guiding light, was probably something like, is it legal? Would his mum think it was okay? And was it a net positive for the kids or the charities? If it passed that test, he was up for it. So one of the things I observed him doing was supporting the charities that his biggest customers supported. Suddenly, he'd have an interest in a new charity. And this was seen, the biggest example I saw of this was in 2011. He took the Wix leadership team, so Wix, the builder's merchant, you know, the chain of DIY stores. He took their leadership team exploring in Ecuador, and they climbed Ecuador's highest mountain, Cotopaxi. And they bonded, and they, you know, they shared tents and all that stuff. 3 years after that, the Wicks Cotopaxi expedition, the Wicks CEO called Hoppy. He said, "It's bad news. We are having to sack you. We're having to fire your business." And this was a big deal. Wicks were 40% of my dad's business at the time, so it was either a lot of redundancies or probably a failed business. But in Jeremy's next breath, Jeremy Bird, that was the CEO, Jeremy said, "But we're going to give you the time you need. You know, we will give you as much time as you need to fill the hole we're going to leave you with to protect the jobs and stay alive." And that kindness that was not in Wicks's best interests. They did it because they loved Hoppy and they wanted to help him. And in fact, Hoppy and Jeremy did business again a few times after that event. And when Hoppy died, Jeremy, who now lives in South Africa, flew in and to pay his respects to my mum and visit my dad's grave, which I don't think that's a common thing for someone that was a customer once who fired you would do. If we go under the bonnet of this principle and we think about what good business is, it usually comes down to great relationships, great, long, you know, real, sincere relationships. And I think when you raise money with people, and which is hard, by the way, that's a hard thing to do, raising a lot of money for people, you bond over the experience and you create these deep relationships. And Hoppy knew that. And I think that's an interesting principle to share with you today. Okay, home stretch, last principle. Principle 4, you can do the things you love and help others at the same time. This is my favorite one, so I'm gonna say it again. You can do the things you love and help others at the same time. A recent hobby of Hoppy's was collecting modern British art. And through this hobby, he got to know a number of famous artists, including a chap called Harland Miller, whose works sell for over £100,000 and a cracker's amount of money. When the pandemic hit, Hoppy wanted to help. So he wrote to Harland with an idea. He called him Harlando. He said, "Harlando, got an idea. This is bad. We can do good. Why don't we make a copy of one of your famous pieces of art and sell a limited print online? What do you think, Hoppy?" Harlando wrote back, "Hoppy, love the plan. Let's do it. Peace and love, Harlando." Within 30 minutes of these prints being for sale online, Hoppy and Harlando had raised over £2 million for the NHS. The piece of art in front of me, well, it's a piece of art, is the first of the prints that they sold. It's number one, and it's great. Who cares wins in NHS blue. And it sits proudly in my dad's office behind his chair, which I have been in recent times. Mum will tell you, I squat there probably a couple of days a week, and it makes for an incredible Zoom background. unless you're trying to maybe reprimanding somebody, and it sends the wrong message. Anyway, so there's a couple of little things I want to shine a light on with this principle that I don't think are immediately obvious. The first is, when you do good doing the things you love the things you love more, okay? So Hoppy's love of art was enhanced when he realized he could use it to raise money for others. And I bet, he never actually said this, but I bet when he went into his office and he saw that thing on the wall, which he loved for what it, you know, NHS story aside, but then with the story that he'd raised a load of money doing it, he would have loved it a million times more. So I think that's an interesting observation. Hoppy's hobbies became more interesting to him when he leveraged them to do good work at the same time. And the second point that I think is worth pointing out applies to principle 3 and 4. Hoppy approached charity quite differently to most of us. So, you know, the stereotype is once a year or every couple of years, you do a 10K and you raise a couple hundred quid. And by the way, that is a great thing. Like, that's better than nothing, a million times better than nothing. But it wasn't Hoppy's style. Hoppy's charity scanner was always on. Whether he was at work, or he was doing his hobbies, or he was spending time with his family. I said at the start of this lecture that he's summited Kilimanjaro 10 times. Well, he wasn't on his own. We've all been and had some of our best, you know, some of the best father-son bonding was in a tent in Africa. And we happened to raise thousands of pounds while doing it. So there are your four principles. Thinking big, connecting with where the money's going, using charity to help your business, and doing good while doing the things you love. So what's it been like? What's this stuff? How's it affected me growing up around this stuff? Well, on the day Dad died, me and my brothers were at his house, my mum and dad's house, and we were feeling pretty broken, which I was, you know, it's just normal, I'm sure. But we thought that's probably not what Hoppy would be doing, sat down feeling very sad. He'd probably be outside, maybe walking the dogs or something. So we thought we'll go for a little run. So we set off jogging together. And a couple of kilometers in, I said to my brother that's here, in fact, I'm afraid I'm going to pick on you now because I want to use you. He doesn't know this is happening. Can you just stand up for a second, Oliver? Come on, stand up. He didn't expect that. So this is Oliver. So I said to Oliver, I'm going to ask you to respond in a second. I said, should we run 100 kilometers together? And Oliver looked at me like I was completely mad, and then he said, let's do it. That was all. That's you. You sat down now. Thank you. Thank you. So we set off on an ultra marathon without the appropriate training. We had our phones with us, and we played music that Hoppy loved. We had the Blues Brothers soundtrack on repeat, which became really annoying, but it was fine at first. And then we realized quite soon we needed fuel. Like, we were going to, you can't run 100 kilometers on a bowl of porridge. So we rang Hoppy's best mate, Nelly, who turned up with flapjacks and water and became mission support. And he ran 10K with us with a gammy leg. And then we realized other people were running. My Uncle Jez videoed in. He was running. I've never seen him run. And by the end of the day, we'd run the Hoppy 100. We've now called it 100 kilometer distance on the day Dad died, which makes me very proud. Okay, if you look at, just switching tack a little bit, if you look at my business and how this stuff has affected it, I run a marketing agency with the same daft lad that stood up a moment ago. And most marketing agencies, when they grow and win business, they have to do a little bit of free work to kind of prove themselves. That's how the model often works. And we've never done that. We've always said, whenever we pitch or do favors, you've got to make £1,000 donation to charity. And we've been doing this for 4.5 years now. And it makes me very proud to say we've given more away to small local charity with that mechanic than dividends we've returned to our shareholders in the history of the business's life, which has got Hoppy all over it. The final Hoppy-ism that I'll share is another business-related one. 2 years ago, our little business, we were working with about 10 clients, and the biggest one was acquired. It was bought by another business. It was bought by Halfords, the big chain of bicycle stores. And Halfords had a marketing agency already that did what we do. So they saw our contracts and they said, I'm sorry guys, we need to cancel this. And this was a crisis for us at the time. So we called an emergency board meeting. And we were planning the various doomsday options when, like this gentleman's phone, I got a phone call. Chris Taylor, by the way, is one of my heroes. He was one of my best mates' dads growing up. And I needed that, so thank you. So that my phone went, And I was like, I've got to take it, so I took it. And the call was from a guy called Jim Barnard. I didn't know that name, but it sounded familiar. Jim was a director at Halfords, about three levels up on the, you know, from the person we'd been dealing with to this point. Turns out Jim used to be a director at Wix. 10 years ago, he'd shared a tent up a mountain in Ecuador with a chap called Hoppy, who he quite liked. And the next thing we knew, instead of being fired by Halfords, we were negotiating what the next 5 years working with them would look like, which I think is a really cool story. Anyway, right, let's lift it. Let's end with a bit of a lift. I don't want this to be a story about a sad story about a son losing his dad, even though that is a theme. I'd rather that you remembered this lecture as an interesting tale of a chap you probably don't know, but who lived a quite interesting life, with some bits of stuff we might be able to pinch for ourselves. And if I'm allowed two takeaways, not one, they're not really takeaways, they're kind of asks for you, really. My first ask is that we leave, if we leave today and we think a little bit more ambitiously, and which requires us to think about how do we deal with that fear that creeps in? What are we gonna do to work on that and stop it stopping us do the good stuff? I think that would be a lovely outcome of me talking today. My second ask or takeaway is for us to take charity out of a box. If we compartmentalize charity, like most of us do, our ability to help people is limited, it's restricted. If we can flip into always on mode, and it doesn't need to be the big grand stuff, by the way, but if we can just scan for the little opportunities to help every day or every week, at the end of our time, if you add all that up, it will make a huge difference. And when Hoppy left us, and I know this because I was there, I know he was really, really happy and proud. And it's because it helped a lot of people. Thanks for listening.
Thanks very much, Max, and thank you very much for the invitation to speak this evening. I think as all pupils and all boys will know that I can now relax a little bit because I've done actually the most difficult part of the evening, which is to walk up those stairs without falling over. But I will say it may be 18 years since I left school, but the hall is still as big and intimidating as ever. So, my name is Philip Worthington, and I'm a human rights lawyer and the managing director of the NGO European Lawyers in Lesbos. We're a charity, and we've been working in Greece since 2016. We have teams of Greek lawyers and volunteer European lawyers and provide free legal assistance to refugees on the islands of Lesbos, Samos, and on the mainland in Athens. I left school in 2003 to study history, first at York and then at Cambridge. And I had aspirations of becoming an academic, but after 4 years of studying the very, very long dead, I realized I wanted to help people in the living world. So I decided to start studying law. And after studying law, I spent a year working at two environmental law NGOs, and then started working as a lawyer at a commercial firm. It was very interesting work. We were helping charities and NHS hospitals and universities, but I knew deep down that it wasn't really what I wanted to do. The problem was that, as I think you know, many people experience, that I just didn't know how to help. And of course, I saw conflicts and crises on the news, but they all seemed so far away, and I just had no idea where to even begin. This all changed in late 2015 with the so-called refugee crisis in Greece, where over 1 million refugees were fleeing from Turkey to the Greek islands, primarily from Syria, fleeing the brutal civil war that was going on then. And just as a small side point, I really hate the term, the refugee crisis. I refuse to consider that offering sanctuary to people who are fleeing war should be seen as anything other than upholding the most basic human right. It should be a neutral, a non-political thing, something on which we can all agree that everybody should be able to live in safety, free from the threat of war or persecution. By January 2016, I'd been working as a lawyer for 6 years, but I just couldn't stand by and see a situation like this unfolding in Europe, only 4 hours flight away from London. I knew I had to do something to try and help. I didn't know what this might be, but I quit my job and flew to Lesbos. And when I got there, there were hundreds, if not thousands, of European and international volunteers on the island. I spent a couple of months working as an ordinary volunteer, handing out food and clothes and tents to people who, at that point, there were tens of thousands of people transiting through the island. They would only spend 24 hours or so on the island because the borders in Europe then were still open. So people would spend 24 hours on Lesbos, get the ferry to Athens, and then carry on up the Balkan route to Northern Europe, to Germany, Netherlands, France, and Belgium. Now, after a couple of months of this, there was a huge change. So in March 2016, the EU-Turkey deal happened. This basically was a deal whereby the EU paid Turkey 3 billion euros to stop refugees crossing from Turkey into Greece. And at this point, most volunteers went home, most NGOs left, because the rhetoric from Athens and Brussels at that point was that the refugee crisis had been solved. But actually, what happened was it turned it into a legal crisis. The borders had closed, but there were still hundreds of thousands of refugees trapped in Greece, and still hundreds arriving every day. All of these people now had to claim asylum in Greece. Now, the asylum procedure is a legal procedure, and there are various legal stages. There's the initial registration, there's a few more stages, and then ultimately, everybody has an interview to assess whether they meet the criteria set out in the Geneva Convention, which is namely that whether somebody has a well-founded fear of persecution because of their race, religion, nationality, political opinion, or membership of a particular social group. Now, like any legal procedure, people need a lawyer to be able to navigate the complex process, understand the criteria, gather the evidence, understand the kind of questions they're going to be asked, and be able to actually properly present their case. But there's no legal aid provided to refugees in Greece, and at that point there were only two private lawyers on Lesbos for a population of over 10,000 refugees. So it was in this context that I founded European Lawyers in Lesbos. And I saw that it was easy for doctors and other professionals to go to the islands to volunteer and use their skills, but there was no such mechanism for lawyers. And so the idea was to bring asylum lawyers from across Europe to Lesbos to volunteer for 3 or 4 weeks at a time as lawyers to provide legal consultations to refugees. Our volunteer lawyers work with professional interpreters and the Greek asylum lawyers in the team to make sure that the advice we give is of the highest possible quality. Now, this was the first time that European lawyers had been able to go from one European jurisdiction and volunteer work in another European jurisdiction. And the reason for this is that asylum law is based on European law and international law, so it's pretty common it's very similar across the different European countries, so 90% the same, I would say, between different jurisdictions. So this means that a German asylum lawyer or a French asylum lawyer or a UK asylum lawyer could go to Greece with a little bit of training, then be able to give advice in the same way they would in their home office. And this model was very successful and has now been replicated in other locations in Greece and across Europe. And fundamentally what we do is we provide one-on-one legal consultations to help prepare people for their interview. What this looks like is that there's an initial kind of introductory meeting where we explain the process, followed by a minimum of 2 3-hour legal consultations. We would then accompany the applicant to their interview, prepare supporting written submissions, backed up by detailed legal research. We help families reunite, so we've helped over 1,000 people reunite when they've arrived into Greece, when they have family members in other European countries, and we've assisted over 700 unaccompanied children arriving into Greece. We do group legal information sessions, drop-in sessions, and provide written legal materials. Everything is aimed to get people ready and prepared for their interview. We do this because we believe that fundamentally every refugee should be able to receive free, high-quality legal assistance from an independent expert lawyer. And when I was writing this speech, I was reflecting on this, and I think that this should be uncontroversial. I mean, for the rule of law to be upheld, it's necessary for people to know their rights, to understand the process they're going through, and be able to properly put their case forward. And obviously, this can only be done with the help of a lawyer. But lawyers are not provided by the state, as I mentioned, so the only way somebody can actually access a lawyer is through an NGO like ours. And even 6 years later, this is still difficult for me to comprehend, because we use lawyers for all manner of things, everything from buying a house to multi-million pound mergers and acquisitions. Yet lawyers are not provided for refugees for whom the outcome of their case could genuinely be a matter of life or death. And even beyond that, people ask me, well, why do refugees need lawyers? Surely they just go to their asylum interview and tell the truth, explain what happened. And I would say, well, imagine that you're transported to Kabul and you're told that there's a legal procedure that's going to take place in a few days. It will determine the outcome of your life, yet then you're not going to get any details about what it involves. All the information is in another language and there's nobody there to help you. That's what refugees in Greece face. And for me, the importance of access to legal assistance was brought home to me after I'd been on Lesbos for a few months. I was in the camp, I was in Moria camp, and a guy came to me. He saw that I was a lawyer, we got chatting, and he'd actually already done his interview, so there was nothing we could do to help him at that point. He was just waiting for his decision. And I said, okay, well, how did your interview go? He said, it went really, really well. I said, great, okay. What did you say? And he said, well, I told them that I was a truck driver back in Iraq, and that if they let me stay in Greece, I'd become the best truck driver in Greece, earn lots of money, pay lots of taxes, and become an upstanding member of Greek society. I said, okay, but why did you actually flee Iraq? And he said, well, because I'm from a religious minority and a militia killed my family. I said, did you tell them this? And he said, of course not. I don't want them to think that I'm vulnerable, that I'm going to be a burden somehow on them. And it really struck me that what he said made complete sense, but what he'd actually said from an asylum law perspective was the worst thing he could have said. He'd basically said, I'm an economic migrant. And at that stage, there was nothing he could do. He couldn't change it. And only half an hour with a lawyer would have made him realize that what he was going to say was absolutely the wrong thing to say, and would have, actually given him the opportunity to put his case forward, which was a strong case, in a proper way. So through our work, we try and provide meaningful access to legal assistance, uphold the rule of law, and defend human rights. And we initially planned to be on Lesbos for just a year, but that was very naive as things turn out, because of course the situation continued deteriorating. Lesbos is only around 10 kilometers away from Turkey, across the Aegean Sea, and so tens of thousands of people have continued arriving from Turkey to Greece, particularly from Syria, Afghanistan, and Iraq over the past few years, making the journey in tiny little rubber boats, and then ending up in Moria camp on Lesbos, which is infamous for its squalid and cramped conditions. I'm sure you heard about it on the news. And at its height, there were 25,000 people living in a camp with capacity of only 3,000. In many occasions, it was 20 people living in a single tent or a container for up to 2 years or more whilst they waited for the outcome of their asylum procedure. The conditions there were unspeakably terrible, and far below the minimum standards. So it was more than 70 people for every toilet, more than 80 people for every shower, more than 250 people for every water tap. And actually in 2018, it was described by Médecins Sans Frontières as the worst refugee camp on earth. Now, we worked in Moria, we had an office there. Well, I say it was an office, it was really two shipping containers, and advised dozens of people per day. The camp itself burnt down in late 2020, but the conditions in the new camp are not much better. For us ourselves, in 2020, we set up a new office in Samos, the neighboring island, and last year opened an office in Athens to cover the four camps in the region, which are about 60,000 refugees in the Athens region. We now have over 20 staff, including 9 Greek asylum lawyers, and have welcomed more than 300 volunteer lawyers from over 18 different European countries. We're independent of the government of the European Union and work solely on grants and donations. We continued working throughout COVID-19 and have 20 volunteer lawyers who assist us remotely, and overall have assisted more than 13,000 people. And the work that we have has a material impact. So 69% of those that we've assisted have been granted asylum or some form of protection, compared to an average in Greece of only 32%. What this illustrates is that if refugees know their rights, understand the legal process, and are able to gather the evidence and present their case, they're more than twice as likely to be granted the protection that they deserve. Now, bringing things to the current situation, the situation is more challenging than ever. So there are still tens of thousands of refugees on the Greek islands and over 100,000 on the Greek mainland. And actually more than 60% of these are women and children, primarily from Syria and Afghanistan. Now, the situation was made worse last year because Greece issued a decision that now considers Turkey to be a safe country for people from Syria, Afghanistan, Somalia, Pakistan, and Bangladesh. And what this means is that unless people can specifically prove that they're at risk in Turkey, then their case won't even be heard in Greece. So for example, someone fleeing the Taliban would arrive in Greece, and instead of being given the opportunity to actually ask for sanctuary and put their case forward, they would be deported straight back to Turkey. Indeed, there's been a large proportion of Afghans arriving since the fall of Kabul last year. Over 70% of those arriving to Esvos last year were from Afghanistan. However, the asylum procedure has been getting stricter and more hostile, with an overwhelming focus on speed. In fact, I would go so far as to say that the rule of law has been sacrificed in the name of speed. People now get their interview within 3 days of arriving onto the island, and can be called for interview with less than 24 hours notice, meaning, of course, it's impossible for people in that situation to see even a doctor, never mind a lawyer. This obsession about numbers, in terms of increasing the speed, reducing the asylum backlog, and moving people out of the camps, is the cause of this problem. And I can understand it, because from the Greek authorities' perspective, from the European authorities' perspective, it looks good. It looks great from a statistical perspective, but fundamentally, it denies access to justice, dehumanizes the process, and creates a tyranny of bureaucracy, whereby people have to navigate an extremely complicated procedure, and one wrong document or one missed deadline can actually result in their case being closed and the individual being deported. Moreover, the situation has become normalized. We've collectively accepted, as Europe, that we're okay with there being more than 100,000 refugees in Greece living either in squalid conditions in the camps or in and around the streets of Athens and Thessaloniki. And this is the new normal. But, of course, it shouldn't be, and we shouldn't let that happen. I remember when I just arrived on Lesbos, it was January 2016, and I was working in the camp in the middle of the night, giving out tents, I think. And I remember giving a tent to a Syrian family. And when I left a couple of hours later, 3 a.m. in the morning, I remember seeing this family putting up this tent in January. Now, it's Greece, so, okay, a little bit warmer, but still very cold weather. And I remember thinking to myself, it's absolutely unacceptable that A family fleeing Syria has to spend one night living in a tent in Greece in 2016. And I often think back to that because actually, since then, people have lived 2 years or more in similar conditions, just waiting. And this is something that has become normal, but it's not something that we should accept. Now, I suppose the question is, what's the solution to this? Well, it's a European issue, and so needs a European solution. But the solution is not Fortress Europe. It's not making border controls stricter and engaging in pushbacks, which is the illegal activity of physically pushing people back over the sea or land border. Not only is this morally and legally wrong, it just won't work. The push factors are always going to be there. People are fleeing for their lives, so no matter how bad the conditions are in the Greek island camps, people will still come. And all it does is actually force people to take more and more dangerous ways of crossing, with tragic results. Last year, more than 1,600 people died crossing the Mediterranean, and there's been a total of 23,000 dead since 2014. Instead of this, there should be a robust, fair, efficient asylum procedure with guaranteed access to a qualified lawyer, medical support, and humane living conditions. Moreover, there should be a fair and proportionate relocation scheme across Europe. So I've been talking about the numbers, and actually they're not high, only 100,000 people, which, you know, it's actually a third of the size of the total population of Bolton. So if shared fairly across Europe, the numbers are fractionally small. And again, I imagine that most people actually think that what I'm saying is pretty uncontroversial. But the thing is that as a matter of policy choice, the opposite has been done. So now, when I was preparing for this talk, of course, I've been reflecting over the past few years. And I think it's, you know, the first thing to say, it's been an absolute privilege to work with so many inspiring people, many of whom have gone through unspeakable traumas and been living in the most challenging conditions in the camps, as well as working with so many inspiring colleagues who work tirelessly in pursuit of justice. But what have I learned? Well, the first thing is that people are the same the world over. To borrow a line from Barack Obama, there is more that unites us than divides us. There are lots of good people, and of course some bad people, in all communities, irrespective of nationality, religion, or gender. We're all the same. We all have the same hopes and fears, the same problems and challenges, and ultimately, the same dream that our children can grow up in safety. And this was brought home to me when I was in the camp, I think in 2017, and I bumped into somebody, or more precisely, he approached me because he saw I had a jacket on that said European Lawyers and Lawyers Office, and he said, oh, you're a lawyer? And I said, yeah. And we got talking. It turns out that he was from Afghanistan, and he was a lawyer as well. We were talking about things, and we worked out that actually we were exactly the same age. And it really struck me that this man had to flee his country, had come to Greece, and that night I was going home to my apartment in Lesvos, and he was going to sleep with his wife and his two little children in a tent with 16 other people in the camp, and the only difference between us was that I was born in the UK and he was born in Afghanistan. What else have I learned? That we would all do the same in their situation. We would all flee war to protect our family. And this is actually shown by the current situation in Ukraine. You see millions of people who would never have imagined leaving their country having to flee because of war. And it's the same for the Afghans, Syrians, Iraqis, and many other refugees in Greece. Indeed, a Syrian family from Aleppo fleeing the Russian-backed Assad regime are the same as the Ukrainian families we see fleeing Kyiv, and they would be the same as us if the UK were attacked. The last 6 years have shown me the importance of empathy beyond all other characteristics. If we can put ourselves in the shoes of others and ask ourselves, what would we want to happen if we were in their situation, then it cuts through all of the noise and the politics and allows us to assess things on a basic human level. If we had to leave our homes because of war or persecution, how would we want to be treated by the country we fled to? What would we ask for in that position? And I think it's quite simple. We would want to be welcomed, supported, treated with kindness and dignity. People just want a chance. They don't want handouts, they don't want special treatment, just a chance to rebuild their lives in safety. And it should be this human approach that guides our policies and attitudes rather than fear or politics or economics. And for me, watching the response to the Russian invasion of Ukraine has been both inspiring and troubling. It demonstrates that we can show empathy, we can act quickly to respond and put into effect things that would have been unimaginable only a few weeks ago, as well as the sanctions and the companies withdrawing and the military support. The EU has implemented the Temporary Protection Directive, which means that Ukrainians are automatically granted a year protection without having to go through any asylum procedure. They'll also be provided with housing, with jobs and education. This is inspiring, and it's absolutely how it should be. But the question does strike me. Why could this not have been done for the Afghans and the Syrians and the other refugees arriving over the past few years in Greece? We were consistently told that it was impossible or too expensive to provide this level of support, yet the response to Ukraine has shown that this is not true, and it's revealed that it was a policy decision to deny these basic rights and services. I'll leave it up to you to draw your own conclusions as to why the reaction has been different, but what is undoubtedly clear is that it was a choice to treat these two groups differently. So, in conclusion, just to go back to the title of this lecture, Making a Difference in the Modern World. My motivation for establishing ELEAL was to use my skills, knowledge, and experience to help people. And I think it's fair to say that the 14 years I spent at school were integral in this regard, as the concepts of fairness, equality, and therefore justice are central to the school's ethos. Every day we were encouraged to think outside of the box, think outside of the strict academic confines, to think about others and the world outside. The lessons that we had outside of the normal discussions of the curriculum were vital in broadening my horizons and encouraging me to think critically and to challenge assumptions. And I'm delighted that the school continues and has even increased its focus on giving back to the community. And just speaking to the pupils for a second, I would strongly encourage all of you to take advantage of these opportunities, and particularly any opportunities that come for volunteering. Believe me, you'll get a huge amount out of it. Indeed, I would go so far as to say that my decision to quit my job and go volunteer in Lesvos was the best decision I ever made. This kind of experience is very important in making a difference in the modern world, because we live in a global society facing global challenges. It's not enough just to look out for ourselves. We must strive to be a force for positive change in whatever way we can, whether that's through your career, through volunteering, or through having a conversation to challenge the most problematic assumptions. Follow your passion. It's the most powerful tool that you have, and don't be afraid to take risks, and never be silent in the face of injustice or prejudice. And this leads me to my final point. One of the key lessons I learned at school was to challenge everything, that nothing is set in stone. Anything can be changed if we as a society wish it. The biggest barrier to things changing is the mistaken belief that we can't make a difference. We're conditioned by the media, by politics, and the economic system to think that things cannot change, actually because these power structures themselves are created to preserve the status quo. But it's these same structures that actually mean that each of us is more powerful than ever before and have more ways to influence than ever before. We have more ways than ever to having our voice heard through the media, more ways than ever of influencing our politicians, and more ways than ever of ensuring corporations respond to their consumers. It can be done, and this is illustrated by the speed of action in relation to the Russian invasion of Ukraine. It shows that we can put empathy and humanity at the center of decision making, and people are willing to do this even if it costs them personally. It all starts with us. Don't think your voice or your actions do not matter. All it needs is for each of us to stand up and make a difference, and we can change the world. Thank you.
Thank you so much to Philip and to Max for their talks this evening. I think so often, and it will be no secret to the boys in the hall, that we speak often about the Bolton School ethos of making a difference for good in the world. How many assemblies have you heard whilst I've spoken to that theme? But how much more powerful this evening to hear two very different accounts of how boys have indeed left this school as young men and have used their lives to make a real difference for good in the modern world, and to hear just something of how that turned out for them. It won't have escaped the sixth formers in the audience either that you have only a little less than 20 years for at least two of you to be able to stand on this stage and account for yourselves. And I think that is tremendously impressive as well. And wouldn't it be nice to think, and I'm sure you can, that when you did so, that a good scattering of your school friends would be here from, in some cases, far afield to hear you do so. And that is also part of the Bolton School community. What a wonderful evening. Both of our speakers have said that they will take questions, and we have 5 or 10 minutes to take questions and hear some answers to those. That will work much better if you were to raise a hand and ask some, of course. It's always awkward to do a question and answer session if there are no questions. So I'd be most grateful if you joined in. It's a participatory activity. We're at school, pop a hand up, that's how it works. And I will choose you and you can ask a question of either Max or Philip or both if it is a wide-ranging point. Who is going to begin? Excellent, I have a question from a young man right there. In order to ask it, the microphone might assist. Matthew, just hurry the microphone to our brave question asker.
I think I always knew, but I think the issue was that I didn't know how. It's not to say that I didn't enjoy working in commercial law. I did. I just had that nagging feeling that it wasn't what I wanted to do. And I think that this is a very, I was talking with the Year 10 English class earlier today, and I think it's something that we talked about there, that it's okay to not know. It's okay to start a career and try something and then realize it's not right for you. It's much better to do that and change than it is to stick with something that you don't enjoy, because careers are very long and it's 40, 50 years spending that time doing something you don't enjoy is the wrong thing to do. It's far better to change and to try something else. So for me, I was always interested in public interest issues, public interest law. As I mentioned, I worked for an NGO after I left university. I actually originally wanted to be an environmental lawyer. So I always had that feeling. I just didn't know how to do it. So I think in answer to your question, I think I always knew, I just didn't know how.
Thank you very much. I think there was a question in the row in front, was there? Can you just pass the microphone along?
It's a good question. This is maybe not a good answer. I don't know. I think I got most of my charity inspiration from my dad. I think that this school built on it. This school, we did lots of expeditions with this school. I seem to remember going on a Trans-Scotland canoe trip with Trevor Pledger, although my memory might be a bit vague there. But this school was quite, you know, Patterdale Hall. I remember doing a Greece and Turkey trek camp trip. So I think this school showed me adventure. My dad showed me about combining charity with basically everything, so I went on to combine charity with adventure. But I think it was my dad, if I'm being completely honest to the question, that showed me about
how to follow in his footsteps. I just watched him and I idolized him. Yeah.
Thank you. Are there any other questions? I see a question just here. Can we get a microphone along and then possibly those one back there, was there? So those can be the next two. Thank you very much. I think that was, I was struggling to hear all of your question, thank you. I think an invitation to expand on what you touched on in your talk about the potential differences between the Syrian refugee and the Ukrainian refugee.
Yeah, thank you. It's a very, very interesting question. I think the truth of the matter is that we can't escape that there is a different treatment, and there shouldn't be a different treatment. To put it as in as blunt and as simple terms as possible, there is clearly a racial and religious aspect to this. I myself, I've spent 6 years working in Lesbos, yet when I saw the people fleeing Kyiv and see the families crossing the border, it hit me very hard. And I did ask myself, well, why? Why is this hitting me harder than seeing similar things from Syria or Afghanistan? And the truth of the matter is, it's just more familiar to us. We recognize it. We think, well, you know, that could be me. That could be somebody I know. And I would say that, you know, I think this differential treatment is absolutely unacceptable and is not how it should be. It should be absolutely equal treatment, not based on anything other than are people in need of protection. And I think that the Ukrainian situation offers an opportunity for us to all look at ourselves and say, why are we treating these two groups differently? Why is it that for these people, we basically opened the borders and provided all support, which is what we should do. Yet for other nationalities, the opposite was true. We closed the borders, we've restricted the opportunities for people. It takes a Syrian person who's, you know, who's a recognized refugee, it will take them a year or more to renew their residence card in Greece. All that time, they can't work. So there is a clear differential treatment, and I think we do need to reflect on that and ask ourselves, at its very heart, why are we treating people differently?
Thank you very much. Did I see perhaps a final question over here? Can we have that question? Just over there. Pop a hand up again so that the mic can find you. Thank you. Our final question. Let's listen up.
This is a question to Mr. Warfield. So would you say there's ever a point in your volunteer career that you feel regret about giving up a stable commercial job?
No. But I mean, maybe my parents may have a different viewpoint on this. But for me, no, never. Actually, I would say that almost the moment I arrived on Lesbos and started working, I knew it was the right thing. Because ultimately, as I said before, it's not the right thing to do for anybody to pursue a career you don't believe in. And it's okay to take risks. Actually, I'd say it's a very good thing to take risks. If you know what your passion is, you know what you want to do, then take those risks to achieve it, because we only have one life. And so do everything you can to follow your dream and follow your passions. So for me, no, there's never been a moment. There's been some extremely difficult times. You can imagine that the stress of working in a situation like that, the hours it involves, the emotional aspect it involves, can be extremely difficult and draining. But never for a second did I think I'd made the wrong choice or I want to give up.
Thank you very much. And now may I call upon Finlay Littlefair, the Vice Captain of School, to give a vote of thanks.
Good evening, everyone. The vote of thanks, to echo the words of Oliver Hopkinson, which I'm sure we'll all remember, let's do it. I know I don't need to say anything in order to invite us all to say thank you to Max and Philip, because their incredible and thought-provoking contributions speak for themselves. As such, I would like to say thank you to each of you, sincerely, even if the vote of thanks might seem like something of a contrived formality. However, it is very important for us to recognise the commitment that Max and Philip have made to this evening, which has turned out to be so inspirational and important for us all, and for us students, to echo the words of Mr. Britton, the head of Foundation, has made the prospect of doing something with your life so much more tangible. I can say that as a Year 13, both of you have given fantastic examples of, and I hope you'll forgive the incidental comment on your age here when you realise that I'm actually rounding it down, who could we be in 15 years' time? The common threads of both of your accounts of those initial steps, or those initial years even, of hard work, of building up skills and expertise, and then taking that forward to build things that really are so impactful. For Max, a business that gives so much back. For Philip, the building of a role as a lawyer that gives people a new lease of life. In fact, in a sense, doubles some people's chances of leading a new, safe life. So this justification for what we might call hard graft is something that I can tell you is very heartening as a Year 13 in the throes of A-level preparation. I want to thank you for, I think, what I've taken away as the key message of both of your talks, which is that the command that is, let us in Year 13 not grow up to become businessmen of business or lawyers of the law, but instead people of charity and humanity. Thank you to Philip for telling us, showing us the importance of empathy in all aspects of our lives. And thank you to Max for sharing a touching story about an interesting man, or shall I say, an interesting tale about an interesting man who led an interesting life. And finally, thank you for coming back. Thank you for coming back to school. It's very much a circular thing that represents faith being given to future generations, but also looking back and investing something, namely a significant amount of time, effort, and gall on a Monday evening, as Philip said to me earlier, preparing for this talk was more nerve-wracking than preparing for a speech at the UN. So this is something that Max and Philip have both done that deserves applauding, as well as putting up with the potential embarrassment of seeing their old teachers and deciding that that was worthwhile. In fact, I was present to witness today Max tell Dr. Yates that he hasn't aged a day I imagine after realising that Dr. Yates is every bit as physically imposing as he remembers that he used to be. I agree. So, if I can invite us all to say and give another deserved another deserved round of applause to say thank you to Max and Philip for their incredible contributions to an evening.
Finish, may I just add my thanks to you as an audience here in the Great Hall this evening, and of course to those who have been joining us online this evening on the streamed version of the Tillotson Lecture. I wish you all a happy evening. If you are here in the hall, do join us for refreshments, and if you're at home, pop your own kettle on and enjoy a cup of tea. Thank you very much.